I'm Andrew Mazzone, president of the Henry George School of Social Science. I have the honor and pleasure today to interview Dr. James Galbraith, professor at the University of Texas, president of the Board of Economists for Peace and Security, and member of the Galbraith family, the royal family of economics in America. Dr. Galbraith joins us today to discuss his new eye-opening book, Welcome to the Poisoned Chalice. This earnest, honest, and timely work describes Greece currently as the canary of the world of the future, a nation pummeled by stronger, bullying nations not ashamed to show their overwhelming power. The lack of sympathy, empathy, or any consideration for Greece's future is perfectly documented from the inside by Dr. Galbraith. But as Dr. Galbraith demonstrates, the future doesn't have to be this way. With countries like Greece, Spain, Portugal, and perhaps even France at the mercy of the Troika, the triumvirate of the European Union, the European Central Bank, and the International Monetary Fund, all strongly influenced by Germany, this can be changed if a democratic Europe will arise in self-awareness in order to make this structural change to make Europe work again for all. The Poisoned Chalice is the moral equivalent of Keynes's 1921 book, Economic Consequences of the Peace. Well, Dr. Galbraith, thanks for letting us discuss your new book, The Poisoned Chalice. I think we were going to be the first ones to interview you in depth on that book, and we wanted to do this. We wanted to do this very much because we think all the fault lines of modern society are cohering in Greece, and your book is a wonderful description of all of those fault lines. So we'll have to pick it off piece by piece. So the first thing I want to discuss with you is the influence of economic theory on what happened in Europe in the context of neoliberalism, Keynesianism, and so forth, that Europe seems to be, you know, a good exemplar of neoclassical economics now institutionalized and now being pushed to the limit. And your thoughts on that?
Well, first of all, thanks for coming up here, and it's a real pleasure to be with you again. On this question, it's important to understand the historical layers of European development. The original post-war European system, which was very much influenced by the American New Deal, mm-hmm. the British Labour Party and others, and German social democratic ideas, constructed what we think of as the modern welfare state. Mm-hmm. It was not especially Keynesian, but it provided for a very high level of social protection in the major North European countries. Not so much in the South, which were countries that had emerged from fascism in Italy and mm-hmm. later on Spain and Portugal, and Greece, which was in a military dictatorship mm-hmm. until 1974. But in the North, that's what you had. The European construction was overlaid on top of that. And it came about in, the ideas were laid down in, let's say, the 1980s, maybe earlier. They built out of earlier ideas, but they became concrete in the 1980s. At the time when neoclassical economics, what we call neoliberal thinking, had become dominant again. And so these institutions reflected that ideological tendency. Most notoriously, the European Central Bank was set up as this kind of monetarist economist's fantasy of a completely independent, constitutionally independent institution with only inflation control in its charter, a very impractical idea, in fact, which is not observed in the practice. And the European Union didn't have a federal budget to speak of. So it couldn't do the kind of social welfare construction that the federal government of the United States started doing in the 1930s.
You make that point very clearly, the difference between federalism and the construction in the United States. I mean, that point is eloquently made in your book. But why change what was a successful model for the Europeans.
Well, I think what was emerging here was basically a reactionary impulse to undo the post-war social construction. Anyway, that was certainly the effect. By leaving the social functions at the national level and putting everything under extremely strict budget rules, which is what happened after 1999, especially when the euro came in, the effect of this was to put constant pressure on the European states to cut back labor protections, to cut back social insurance, to cut back public education, to cut back their national healthcare systems. I think that was intentional. I know it was. Mm-hmm. It is something that's still being heavily fought in France. But if you look at a place like Greece, where the institutions were never very strong to begin with, were really built up in the 80s under Andreas Papandreou, the effect has been devastating. Public health, public education, the basic structure of urban life.
But you think, why would the European population have acquiesced to this kind of change? I mean, with the exception of Germany, which we'll discuss separately, all the rest of the countries, this was all a negative at the end of the day.
I don't think the populations did acquiesce. I think they're furious about it. They're obviously at this point in open rebellion in many places.
How come they don't have the levers to counteract any of this?
Well,
which gets us to Greece. Surely.
Yeah, and I think the answer to that is they're taking what levers are offered to them. In Greece, quite miraculously, after 2011, a party emerged which offered a coherent argument that was a progressive pro-European argument, and that was the Syriza, the coalition of the parties of the radical left. That was a truly exceptional development. Elsewhere in Europe, in France, in Britain, notably also in Germany itself, the impulse of rebellion has come from the right. UKIP in Britain, the National Front in France, the Alternative für Deutschland.
Well, that's kind of an anti-immigration, keep our cultures clean kind of a reaction.
In part, it is. It pulls together a number of things. One of them is this ethno-nationalist reaction. Mm-hmm. And the other one is, in France, for example, the National Front really has taken over the old Gaullist identity of the role of the nation state as being the principal driving force, as against the internationalist Europeanist view, which has been something to which the mainstream left has become fatally attached. And so you have the rise of Marine Le Pen on that score.
Marine Le Pen is certainly much more of a nativist than de Gaulle ever was.
No, that's right. She's combining these two things, but she's less of she emphasizes the Gaullist tradition more than her father did.
In this context, I want to discuss autarkic national development versus a globalized a development. I think that bears onto this. That tension is all over the place. If you look at a development of the United States, which was autarkic in many ways until it reached its full dimension, you could argue it's a large market, large country, and it could be self-sufficient. And in that self-sufficient, it could develop technologies, refresh these technologies, and build itself up at a tremendous rate. By diffusing that kind of a national effort globally, although you can bring the rest of the globe up a certain level, you lose that cutting-edge individual nationalist development. Now, the argument would be, we don't want nationalism to an extreme form. We had World War I, we had World War II, where Japan, Germany, the United States, England, all become the autarkic driving states to take everybody over. So I would argue that the European project, the Asian projects from the United States, would have kind of diffused that and globalized and mute that kind of heavy technological drive. But the point is, you sacrifice quite a bit when you do that, and you take Europe now. You know, what are the driving forces of technology? What are the driving forces of development, which are not submerged under the political action of the superstate. And what can be done about that? Does everyone have to sacrifice their national developmental goals for a broader view of things just so that you won't have wars and strife? And if you do, look what you get. You get an effective dictatorship of bureaucrats.
Well, it's true that to run a very large integrated continental economy, Europe, you need a government establishment, and therefore a bureaucracy. You need that for regulatory purposes. You need it to manage quite a number of things, including the monetary system. So I don't think that's the issue. The issue is whether you have, first of all, an appropriate democratic control and accountability, which Europe lacks. And the issue is whether you have a functioning set of institutions. And Europe at the moment is fatally unbalanced in that second respect, insofar as in order to make a big continental economy work, you have to be able to keep, if you like, the circular flow going. Mm-hmm. Against a very strong tendency for things to concentrate. There's a very strong tendency for the country, the region that has industrial advantage, which
Germany, of course,
for activity to move there. And not just, I mean, it's all the manufacturing, the advanced manufacturing, but it's also things like agriculture. I am told now that more olive oil is produced in Germany than in Greece.
Really?
Well, why is that? Well, because the Germans have the machinery and they import the raw olives and can produce it more cheaply than the Greeks can. So the Greeks suppliers become basically the supplier of the raw material rather than the producer of the final product, and they lose the value added that goes north. That's a process of divergence, which is inherent in having an industrial superiority, and it has to be countered somehow.
Well, it's built in. Let's just take that point, which is a key point. Germany is the hegemon now because of that. I mean, with a currency that's fixed for everybody, German efficiency sooner or later had to outproduce everybody and corner all of the significant markets.
Again, let's be clear. This is a big economy. France has certain specific advantages in aerospace and in engineering, in nuclear power. Italy has certain advantages, particularly in design and in fashion, that kind of thing, but also in certain engineering areas, mining. So there are strengths around Europe.
But the weight of surpluses.
But there's a tendency for things to
centralize.
And so what do you do about that? Well, in the U.S., we do two things. We do quite a number of things, but two very important ones. One of them is the military budget. The military budget is actually spent in parts of the country which are not the industrial centers. That helps distribute things. Even more important than that is the social welfare system, Social Security, healthcare, and so forth. People who earn their livings in New York retire in Florida, and they are receiving and spending their incomes where there, and that helps keep things in balance. We also allow a lot more adjustment. Europe has a special problem. It's a coalition of countries, and it is not permissible in the European setting for some country to become depopulated, dispossessed. At least it's not ethically contemplated. But that's what's happening now.
Even in the United States, it's a relative thing. It's not the same coverage, relatively speaking, that we once had. We have centralizing here, especially in finance. And we're not protecting all of our populations like we once did, at least with jobs.
But that's true.
Let's go back to Europe. I mean, Germany is a hegemon economically, and yes, France and Italy may be fellow travelers in certain selected industries, but by and large, the initiative now lays with Germany in terms of its powerhouse all around industrial facilities, its middle-level companies which are extensive, its ability to trade with China, Russia, it's marginalizes almost everybody, and Europe takes on a German cast when you think about it. Now let's take a look at Greece relative to this. Greece is confronting this monolith, really, with absolutely no way of fighting or controlling or shaping its destiny. It buys German products the only way it can, by borrowing money. Germans are fine with that as long as the bill doesn't come due too quickly. It keeps everything circulating, the loans are extended. But the net effect for countries like Greece, Portugal, and all the marginal countries that have nothing really to counter with is intense marginalization and pauperization, which you demonstrate eloquently in Greece, which is beyond the pale of any modern industrial country. How could this be possible? How could Europe allow this? How could they bully this one country to the point of submission? And in effect, in all the negotiations and all the things that you documented, you watched this, and it didn't seem to be one drop of remorse.
Well, what happened here was that from 1999 until 2008, Greece and the other countries of Southern Europe grew on the strength of the borrowing that you described. In some cases, it was real estate borrowing. In Greece's case, it was predominantly the public sector. Now, they borrowed for infrastructure projects. They borrowed to support the deficits in the healthcare system, which were covered up in part with the complicity of the European authorities. They borrowed some for to support their military, and there were kickbacks and graft. And the place was not obviously well run. It was very poorly run. When the crisis hit, of course, the bills come due, and they can't be paid. And the problem then was the potential for very substantial losses of the German banks, the French banks especially, and Greek banks that were subsidiaries of the French banks. That was the policy concern. So you're asking why, how could they do this, what they did from 2010 onward to Greece? The answer is very simple. They needed a smokescreen behind which they could bail out the French and the German banks. And the smokescreen was, we are rescuing the Greeks. The fact was what they were doing was shoveling money into Greece that was just as immediately shoveled back to buy out the Greek debts held by the North European banks. And the ultimate holder of the liability became not the banks, which where it could have been written down, but the taxpayers. And they spread it out, not just German taxpayers, but the taxpayers of Slovakia, the taxpayers of all the EU countries took a cut, Portugal, countries which aren't as wealthy as Greece in some cases. And so you were basically saying to these less wealthy people, you take a share of the Greek debt and the Greeks will pay you back. Well, the Greeks were unable and are unable to pay them back, but these people are unable, the creditors now, are unable to admit that they conned their own taxpayers.
These are responsible politicians. These are trained people. These are educated people.
I know what you mean by responsible politicians.
Well, I mean, but they're theoretically, I mean, solid citizens.
Theoretically.
They're people that have to know better. This is a...
Oh, they knew better. And absolutely, they knew better. This was the a classic case of an ugly, cynical maneuver. And it gets worse. It gets worse because the IMF was brought in. The IMF was brought in because the IMF designs adjustment programs. So they needed the imprimatur of that in order to sell the whole package to their own northern taxpayers. Now, why did the IMF go in? Well, the IMF can't go in unless it certifies that the debt is going to be sustainable. In order to make that certification, the IMF had to compromise itself. And this has become very clear in the review of the IMF that is just published. The IMF had to basically commit a massive fraud by pretending that the Greek economy would recover quickly when the staff and many of the executive directors knew it would not. Was there any ulterior reason why the IMF went in? I think yes, two reasons. One is that the US pressured it because the US was afraid of the exposure of American banks through derivatives. And secondly, the managing director of the IMF,
Christine Lagarde.
No. At the time, it was a person of impeccable ethical standards known as Dominique Strauss-Kahn.
Yes.
He wanted to be president of France. Hmm. And if you're the managing director of the IMF and you bring a lot of help under the table to the French banking system, they're going to remember that when election time comes around. So we're looking at the subordination of an important international agency. I'm not a great fan of the IMF, but it is an important international agency for entirely illegitimate purposes and with a method that was fraudulent. In fact, that's what happened in 2010. That's the situation that set the stage for the debacle that occurred over 5 years in Greece.
Talking about the populations of the aggrieved countries like Germany, and I suppose that the Slovaks and the Finns, what do they think is happening here? Do they think the Greeks were just bad people and irresponsible people? And what makes them think that they have to be on their moral high horse here to castigate the Greeks as if the Greeks somehow were dissolute and irresponsible in creating this?
You know, all through the crisis and the time that I was engaged with Greece in the first part of 2015, we would hear of Germans and other North Europeans who were in Greece. And those interactions were all very positive. With people acknowledging that the narrative that they were being fed by their media was false. Okay. But what's happening in the countries themselves is clearly a campaign, a vulgar campaign of vilification, really rooted in narratives that we would quickly recognize as racist, where you know, the people talk mm-hmm. about the Greeks had their party and now they must pay, that they don't work very hard, they're not very productive and so forth, and of course they don't collect taxes. All of this story, most of which is, certainly so far as it reflects characteristics of population, completely false. Mm. The Greek people
work harder, actually.
The Greek people are, in fact, very hardworking people. They work longer hours and take fewer vacations than the Germans and so forth. No German civil servant has ever asked to retire on a Greek pension, nor would they. It's clear that this is a self-serving narrative for the press, for the financial sector, and especially for the political classes in the northern countries. And it's something that we had to contend with all the way through.
All right, now we get to the point where you join Yanis mm-hmm. Varoufakis and Syriza, as you were an unpaid consultant, mm-hmm. when they get a mandate from the Greek people, an unusual mandate. No European country, I think, has ever had a mandate like Syriza has received from the Greek people. And here you are, with this mandate, going to confront Europe and the Germans about equity and fairness and relief in a situation that's inhumane. You're starving the population. You're basically gutting a whole nation. The young people have no prospects. As you eloquently described, the place is lined with pawn shops. There's just no real hope in this population. They turn to Syriza. Syriza now is going to confront this European establishment and ask for fair and just relief. And you witnessed this, and it seems that you had a charismatic finance minister who was well known in economic circles, at least in the heterodox economic world. What did you guys think after Syriza? And I'll include you in that, even though you were unpaid and you're unofficial, you served as a resource for the finance minister in supplying, progressive economic agenda and a way to work out of this Greek problem. But it seems to me you fellows ran into just almost an iron curtain roadblock from day one, where all they wanted to do was denigrate, push, beat down, and not hear any of this. What did you guys think?
Well, I arrived in Athens on the first day of the new parliament, which was February 8th of 2015, and I went directly to the finance ministry and went up to the, it's a very dingy building, I went up to the sixth floor, the minister's office, there was Yanis. He said, welcome to the Poisoned Chalice.
Yes, that was a great line.
And it was clear to him, clear to both of us, that the squeeze was on, that they were going to have to fight for every single concession or any concession that they might possibly get. It was a moment, it was an extremely dramatic moment in the political life of Greece. The government had just taken power. It had Syriza had 149 seats and then a coalition partner for the majority. It was a moment of exhilarating the atmosphere in the streets of Athens. We were worried a little bit about Yanis's personal security.
Really?
Certainly his wife, who was at that time in Austin, was worried.
Who would be his natural adversary at this point in time?
There was an active neo-Nazi party, still is in Greece, Golden Dawn. It could have been problematic, but it was obvious the moment I arrived that he had 10.8 million bodyguards. The population was surrounding him at every moment. We would walk cross the street and the drivers would honk the horn. A city bus stopped and rolled down the window to give a salute. A crowd of school children would break apart.
Unbelievable.
I witnessed.
Have you ever seen anything like that in your life?
Nothing like it. There has never before in the history of the world been a spontaneous popular demonstration in favor of a minister of finance. It's an unknown event that occurred in Athens. And that continued. I was only there in February for about 3 days, and the whole government flew when I was on the plane to Brussels for start the negotiations.
Were you hopeful? Was the government hopeful?
Well,
were you expecting?
No, we didn't have. I mean, hope was not part of the picture as far as I could see. We knew that we were going into a very tough environment.
You would say you would think from, let's take from an American point of view. Here you had an expression of democracy, an overwhelming expression of democracy.
Well, just on that, the government got about, 36% of the vote in the initial election, maybe 34. But by the time we got to Brussels in mid-February, it was receiving an 80% approval rating.
Okay.
So you had a majority of the people who voted against Syriza at the end of January, backed them by the middle of February. It was utterly astonishing.
A very left set of progressives, probably further left than any other group in modern history here.
Just to describe it was a coalition of people who had left the Communist Party years before, environmentalists, trade unionists, students, and expatriate college professors. So you want to call that left. It was a group that was not part of the
Papandreou
of the previous political establishment at all, neither center-right nor the PASOK center-left. A lot of people from PASOK came over. That's who it was. It was obviously an extraordinary development. It was a break with the classic political class, for sure. It did make it exciting to work with these people, very clear.
But did you think that mandate would somehow diffuse and translate into moving the intractable policy positions of the bureaucrats?
We had limited objectives. We wanted first to buy some time, so that we could have an open discussion of the terms of the financial assistance program. That was the initial goal. The previous government had set, they knew they were going to lose the election. They had set a set of traps, payment deadlines, but especially the financial assistance program was set to expire on the 20th of February. So we had just 3 weeks to negotiate an extension. Initially, there was a sense that we had maybe gotten somewhere, that we got that extension. It became clear very quickly that from the creditor's point of view, nothing had changed. All they wanted to do was to enforce the previous contract, the previous program, which is a clear failure.
So they weren't impressed about the mandate at all.
The Greek developments for the creditors were evoked hostility from every single force on the other side of the table. If you look at the European Central Bank, it was concerned about its institutional power, mm-hmm. any challenge to that. If you looked at the finance ministers in Spain and Portugal, they were concerned about their own left movements. If they made any concessions to the mm-hmm. Greeks, that would encourage Podemos in Spain, for example. If you looked at the ones, the finance ministers from the East, they were all hardcore austerity people, and they...
Why?
That was the basis of their political power. I mean, why they held that view, these were right-wing parties with a kind of radical free market ideology in the Baltics, for example.
They weren't doing that well economically.
No, well, that's, you know, that may be true, but that was who they were.
Okay.
And if they conceded to the Greeks that a different course might be possible, they would be basically contradicting their own internal line. And then for the Germans, well, we did have some sympathy from the French, but the French were not prepared to do anything. The Italians were not prepared to risk any of their capital on Greece.
Were the French, would you say, somewhat disingenuous, riding both horses here? It seems to me that of all the countries in this, the French were the most ambivalent.
The French were the most ambivalent. Were they? Yes, I think it's not an entirely unfair characterization, but I think mainly the French simply felt weak with respect to the Germans, and weren't. We did get some help. The vice chair of the European Commission, Vice President Pierre Moscovici, was helpful in certain parts of the negotiations. So I don't want to say everybody was hostile, and people were at a personal level quite candid. But when it came down to taking the positions, the point was they weren't guided by any sense of what was good for Greece or what might work for Greece.
Or what was good for any individual country.
Well, that's right. But we were making, Yiannis was making very specific arguments why specific elements of the program that had been enforced on Greece were dysfunctional and should be changed. They weren't interested in that. They were weighing this in light of their own countries and their own institutions. And for Wolfgang Schäuble, when he said to Yiannis, they developed quite a good relationship and quite candid. What he said to Yiannis at one of their later meetings was, Yiannis asked him, would you sign this program? And he's paused for a long time and said, as a patriot, I wouldn't sign it. But I cannot make that concession to you because I need to have this program in Rome and I need to have it in Paris.
Which basically admits on the face of it that democracy for the people of Europe is non-existent.
It's a gridlock situation in a very bad state. Yeah, so there's no, if you are expressing the will of a particular country to take a different course, the forces closing in on you to prevent you from doing that are extremely strong.
Okay, now we have in this mix a very charismatic finance minister going against the monolith. And of course, the received wisdom over in America is that you have this cavalier finance minister who's riding around in a motorcycle with leather jackets and basically thumbing his nose at the European establishment and freaking them out and causing this reaction. In other words, this reaction, the implications were in the American press, which is echoing probably the British, is that there would have been negotiations, but Yiannis himself was such a controversial and flamboyant figure, that, and he had his own agenda, whatever that agenda was, they never stated it. I mean, it's obvious he's a patriot, I mean, just from the whole history of it, and his writings, if you know them. And it supposedly infuriated the establishment to lock down on Giannis, and therefore, Giannis is the problem of why they weren't negotiating. Why don't you rebut that?
Well, I've known him now for 5 years. He's a very soft-spoken man, very thoughtful, very much at the top of his game. He knows more about the details of European history, European institutions and policy, economic theory.
Oh, absolutely.
Than any half dozen top economists you can name. And so his actual personality is the opposite of the image that reached the world press.
We could attest to that. We have three interviews with Giannis. Yep. One on a discussion about Piketty that is probably our highest rated interview with hundreds of thousands of of hits. So if you see him with us, this is a measured, smart, intelligent man. If you see him in the American press, the cartoon figures alone in images are unbelievably negative. I mean, he's the second coming of Dracula.
Right. Well, I mean, you're talking about a guy. Well, okay, he's been riding a motorcycle since he was 15. At one point in his career, he was a Formula Four car racer for a year or so. So does he give up the motorcycle, which is a very first of all, he likes it. Secondly, it's a useful thing in downtown Athens. He keeps it. He got rid of the armored limousines that the finance ministry had. Did he change his style of dress in order to become a finance minister? No, he has a particular style of dress. And the prime minister once in the parliament said you can criticize him for his shirts. It just took the view that he is who he is and that he was given the job and he's going to do it.
Well, from a technical point of view, did he do the job? You were there.
Oh, yes, he did the job. The job of the finance minister, his job was to present and argue for an alternative policy path with the European creditors and with the IMF. And his advantage in being able to do that was that he is absolutely equally capable in Greek, speaking to the Greek political community and the population at large, and in English, speaking to his counterpart. So he was totally comfortable operating on the same level as Christine Lagarde or Mario Draghi or Wolfgang Schäuble. As I said, I think there's good reason to believe, in fact, I know for a fact that Schäuble appreciated him personally, that they developed. I mean, these were two very serious people who understood each other. So
the institutional difficulties meet each other full force in the personalities of these two men. The personalities aside, they represented two positions that were not going to be negotiated.
That's correct. There was essentially, and Schäuble made this clear from the beginning that there was not going to be any negotiation. A contract is a contract, and that meant that in order to get anything at all done, the Greeks had to push it up to the next pay grade. And that was called the political level. It meant that you had to have it became necessary for Alexis Tsipras to go directly to Angela Merkel in order to try to work it out. And for those of us who could help to try and bring some forces to bear on Chancellor Merkel from the United States, for example, in order to try to persuade her that the larger interests of Europe lay not in crushing Greece, but in cutting the government.
Okay, yes, that's fair. Without necessarily knowing the details, it didn't seem that she accommodated that need at all.
What I can tell you is that as this process unfolded, and I think it would have been sometime in March, Alexis Tsipras, the prime minister, sent a letter to Angela Merkel, which Yanis drafted along with I think the legal counsel to the Greek government, which laid out the difficulties they were having in the negotiations, the obstruction that they were receiving, the complete impasse that this was.
But she had to know this.
It's not clear what a top leader knows at any given time, because she has told what her advisors want to tell her, and they're going to frame that message internally. You have to go around them. You have to go direct. And that's what they did. They laid it out, and they said, please, let's not let the small problem turn into a big problem for Europe. She responded to that by saying to Alexis Tsipras, come to Berlin. And he went immediately. There were a number of person-to-person discussions. In addition, and at the same time, Yanis came to Washington for the meetings of the fund and the bank. He was the only finance minister at those meetings to meet the President of the United States, to meet Barack Obama.
I heard he had a meeting with...
There was a 12-minute conversation at a reception that the White House was holding.
And I heard I heard the comments from that. Do you want to verify what I heard or not?
Go ahead.
I heard that Obama said, look, you're in a tough position to Yanis. And he said, I wouldn't want to be in your position. But he couldn't offer anything more than that. But he was obviously sympathetic, but basically he had a Pontius Pilate attitude here, and he couldn't really get involved.
I think that's about right. I'll get to the U.S. position. But we had friends. The Greek-American community was solidly behind us. There's something called the Hellenic Caucus.
Yeah, okay.
Four members of the House of Representatives came to a dinner, including a Tea Party Republican from Florida who was solidly behind us because he was Greek. Never mind that this was a government of the radical left. This guy was in our camp. We had obviously support from a large part of the progressive community, the AFL-CIO, for example.
Oh, absolutely.
So we were, and we had sympathetic support from numerous people at high levels inside the government. So we were doing what we could. It did not, in the end, deliver anything. And in part, that is because the United States, other parts of the American security establishment, had other objectives vis-a-vis Germany. Specifically, they needed Merkel on board for Ukraine.
Putin, okay.
For Ukraine. And so they weren't going to challenge her on this other question. And so that strategy didn't succeed in the end. But my view was it was the only strategy that was open at that point. We knew that Chancellor Merkel never plays her cards until the last hand. So it was not to be expected that she would commit. And we knew that the last hand would come at the end of June. And we knew that we'd be out of money as a state at the end of June. So everything, it was really a situation where we knew that there would come a crunch, and we would have to deal with a very difficult situation.
Were the Europeans during this period already exerting incremental pressure day by day, week by day?
Oh yes, the European Central Bank. Central banks' function is to provide an environment of financial stability. And what the European Central Bank did in this case was to violate that in the most malign way. What they did was, first of all, they forced the Greek banks to fund themselves through this mechanism called emergency liquidity assistance, which the ECB controlled, which they could extend or revoke at any given time, and they fostered a climate of fear which paralyzed the Greek banking system. And basically what happened was that any outside bank which had corresponding balances in Greece
pulled them back
okay. So as not to be trapped with funds.
So you guys immediately saw the pressure was unfriendly and unrelenting almost from day one.
So you're negotiating. The revocation of the waiver was February 4th, so that's actually before the government was sworn in.
Now, from a naive point of view in the United States, many people were screaming at the Greeks, rhetorically anyway, why don't you guys have an exit strategy? Why are you going in, taking a pounding that's now becoming clear, it's becoming very one-sided, and you have nothing to fight back with other than perhaps cutting away from the euro and starting out with the drachma to at least give yourself some bargaining power? That never seemed to be in the offing. And that
there was a faction of the Syriza left, headed by the energy minister Lafazanis and the economist Kostas Lapavitsis,
who was a very famous economist in his own right about banking.
Yep. And they argued for a return to the drachma. This was never the policy of the Greek government, nor of the finance ministry,
nor of the population. And would you explain why the government couldn't take that tack? Because the Greek population itself is so distrustful of government, even local government, that they won't entertain a leaving of the euro, which in effect hamstrung everybody. Your comments on that?
That's true. I think there is a tendency on the part of Greeks to think that their own politicians are worse than anybody else's, and I suppose familiarity breeds contempt as the operating rule there. They're not entirely wrong about that, but if they were in Italy or Germany, for that matter, they might take a different view.
Okay, all right. But
the basic point was the Greek population was favorable to the euro, and the government had been elected on a platform of negotiating a better deal within the euro. So it was never in our
charter, so to speak.
In our charter, and there was never any real leverage to be had by threatening an exit move. For one thing, in order to make the exit work, you have to get through the transition. In order to get through the transition, you have to have, first of all, the state capacity to carry it out, even simple things like getting usable cash into people's hands was not easy in the case of Greece, which didn't have access to a good printing press for this kind of thing. Anyway, it would take time, and the time you'd have social and political disruption, we feared. The other big problem, there were many big problems, was that you didn't have, the state was draining its reserves in order to stay current on its debt. And so it had nothing to defend the value of a successor.
Why wouldn't you have just told the opposing negotiators that you're being constricted on their end by the banking system, you want to hold your reserves until this is finally resolved?
Well, because that would have involved defaulting to the IMF.
I see.
And no state wants to default to the IMF if they can possibly avoid it. Okay. So they were caught on that. They were trying to keep current in order to show good faith.
I see.
And that meant draining the national state. It meant draining municipal governments, universities, hospital funds, all of the pockets that a big government has were being tapped. And so we got to the end of that period in a very tight position. What I was charged to do very discreetly with a small group, and actually mostly from Austin.
By the way, that's a wonderfully detailed description of what you were chartered to do in your book, which I think is very surprising in terms of its comprehensiveness. So,
well, we had the benefit of lawyers. We consulted with legal advisors. We consulted with people who had seen similar experiences in other parts of the world. And we had the benefit, of course, of a large literature. People had been writing about this. Which one of the things I did was simply to read what was what was publicly available, or things that had crossed my desk because people sent them to me, and to assemble a kind of picture of what you would have to do. But it was always in the context of, suppose when the crunch comes, the European Central Bank eliminates the emergency liquidity assistance, which has the effect of confiscating the bank deposits of the Greek public. And that's the working capital of Greek business. It means everybody's basically locked up until they can do something. And that would mean you either allow the whole economy to collapse, which would be a formula for mayhem, or you take steps to establish your own means of payment.
Well, but this is a population now that's been brutalized like no other since World War II, in immediate post-war, right? Yep. This is a population that is tragically suffering, where the president, they don't have much to lose here.
Well, that depends on who we're talking about. The state was certainly bankrupted by this, had been bankrupted really since 2010, but was now at the stage where it was practically out of money. Parts of the population were destitute. We were very concerned about them.
How are you feeding? What, 25% of the population is basically broke.
These were very serious issues. But it's also fair to say that a substantial part of the population protected itself. We knew, for example, that Greek businesses were placing their money outside the country. That's money good. They're protected. Greek households were either doing that, or one of the things that we noticed as the spring proceeded was that they were buying assets, cars, particularly used German cars, flew off the lots in Greece. Why? Because you can drive it across the border and sell it if you have to, if you need cash. And people were taking, as I say, other steps. They were drawing down their bank deposits. When capital controls were finally imposed at the forced on Greece by the European Central Bank toward the end of June, something quite extraordinary happened. Greeks, very sensibly, if they had cash in the bank, and they knew that at any moment it could be seized, well, what they did was they started paying their bills. They paid their tax bills. Money flooded into the treasury in those last few days. People were, of course, paying utility bills and other. So the person who doesn't have a bank balance won't lose anything. You were dealing with an intelligent population of a, by world standards, wealthy country, a first world country, that had a, of course, a lot of small business people with a good business sense doing what they were could be expected to do. And the result of that was that this crisis was taken by the Greek people with a huge amount of political maturity. And they firmly supported the government's position to vote and voted no in that referendum.
Yeah, I want to talk about that.
And they took capital controls without any social disruption at all, so far as I know.
All right. Talk about your presence at that no vote. This was a symbolic vote where, the negotiations are going bad. It's clear in the United States that the Greek government is losing everything here, and that now they call for a vote on, I think, basically to strengthen the prime minister's hand and showing maybe moral strength to the Europeans. Right, yeah. And there was a lot of pressure to vote yes, give it up, and succumb. And in fact, I think Yanis Varoufakis thought that it was going to be a yes vote in that. But you attended the rallies and that night's events, the night preceding that that vote. Tell us your impressions of the Greek people and what went on that night, because My understanding, it was an extraordinary night, an extraordinary patriotic night.
I came back into Greece after a week in Italy, the Friday of the big rally. And I, my feeling getting off the plane was almost electric, that this was going to be a no vote. I got to the finance ministry. Yiannis was thought it would be a yes vote. But the rallies made it very clear. The yes rally, I was told, was really quite pathetic. And the rally for no was the largest rally in the history of the Greek Republic. I mean, it was in the middle of Syntagma Square, with crowds just several blocks down every street. And what was striking to me was it was a very serious crowd. This was a somber, determined group of people. It was not, you know, a lot of shouting and yelling. And
I see. Yeah.
It was not. These were people who had turned out to show who they were. Mm-hmm. It was quite impressive. I had rarely been in a crowd that I thought was as sober and mature as.
Were they hopeful? Did they think that?
No, I don't. I don't think they were hopeful or not. They weren't expressing that emotion. They were simply there to show resolve. And that was the overwhelming feeling. And I was very moved, actually. I came up out of the subway and stood in the crowd. And by and by, after 10 or 15 minutes, a couple of older gentlemen came over and just extended their hands. They recognized me. Someone said, thank you for what you're doing for Greece.
How did Yiannis take this? Now, he had to be energized with it, but also conflicted because
he knew
the truth here.
He knew that the government was not going to stand firm, and so this was a very poignant moment.
Yeah, I can imagine.
And when the vote came in, 61.5% no, well, it was a magnificent vote. He went to see the prime minister and made the case that the that they should stand firm, and that they became clear that they were not going to do that, then he made clear that he would resign the next morning, which is what happened. I got an email, actually, about 4 a.m. saying that I honestly was resigning later this morning.
Now, Tsipras, of course, I would argue, should have done the right thing and resigned himself then. What was the point of him presiding over a surrender in his case? I mean, Yiannis did the thing of honor here. I mean, what did Tsipras think he was going to accomplish by being the executor of a policy that he argued vociferously against?
I don't want to criticize Alexis Tsipras for having stayed in place in this situation. When you think things can't be worse, they in fact can be. I don't want to criticize Yiannis's successor in the finance ministry, Euclid Tsakalotos, who has been forced to negotiate and implement this third memorandum that's now in effect.
Which is worse now than anything that you were confronted with.
It's terrible. It's terrible, and it has malign effects all throughout the Greek economy and society. But you know, when you're someone has to do that job, and Euclid took that job with Yiannis's support, I haven't been there in the last year, and these are, I think, deeply personal decisions that people have to make, given their own moral sense. And this is very similar to the position that Lyndon Johnson's advisors had over the Vietnam War. And there were those who felt George Ball for a long period of time, that he had to stay in and keep fighting to try and get the war ended. And there were others who felt that they had to leave and oppose it from the outside. And as I say, it's very hard for me to second guess.
Okay, but now we look back and you've chronicled this event in this situation. And I liken it to, a little different, but liken it to the Keynes' book, The Economic Consequences of the Peace, which had was prescient in predicting World War II. Your book here is a fair evaluation and an up-close personal evaluation of all the events that played here. And what is clear from your book, and the unintended consequence from your book, is it's clear to everybody in the world what happened here. This is, the fig leaf was removed here. There is no pretense. There is no confusing the people in the world about what went on, why it went on. It was so close and intense and personal, all the individual things, that you could read what happened. And if anyone thinks that the democracy is alive in the European Union, or any monolithic government now that's basically, you know, trying to impose austerity and under the influence of neoclassical economics, it's going to come to an end. It's over. This is, you've shown too much. The world has seen too much here. And regardless of what you do or don't do, you've let the genie out of the bottle here. And this is going to go on and on and on. There can be no confusion about this. And now I would argue England left the euro. And of course you can argue why they did and everything like that. But I would say deep down the English got the message here too. And they're going to save themselves if they can. And the knock-on effects of what happened in Greece, which is so wonderfully chronicled by your book, will go on and on and on, regardless of what anyone says and does. That's what I feel.
Well, thank you. I thank you very much for that. I feel I had to write this book. I had to write this book because it was important for the narrative, the history that I experienced, to be seen by other people as I had a chance to see it, and that I had a position of that was authentic, and therefore I could carry credibility. It's not just, I mean, I was there. It's not just like any outside observer. In a world in which most people get their impression of these events from the financial newspapers, for example, it was important to set forth what actually happened as I observed it. I do think you're right that the large populations of the of Europe got a sense for what it was, in spite of the fact that they were being told,
you know, absolutely,
these were the reckless and irresponsible
absolutely,
Greeks.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And the first place that one saw this was Spain and Portugal. And there, at least in the initial round of elections in March in Spain, Podemos came up. Part of the purpose behind the punishing and the strangulation of Greece was to intimidate the voters of other parts of Europe into falling in line. Didn't have that effect. Hasn't had that effect in Italy, where you have a kind of a dance going on between the government, which is quietly distancing itself from the fiscal rules in certain respects, and Five Star, which is aggressively challenging them, and now has the mayoralty of Rome and other major cities. And in Portugal, you got a tripartite left coalition government with very interesting development. And then, as you say, in Britain, the vote to exit the European Union was probably also, to at least some small extent,
yes,
influenced by the treatment of Greece. That's a bit remote for the British, so I don't want to lay on that.
I understand, I may be claiming too much, but everyone gets a sense here. Even if we're in the United States and we're not feeling the pain, everyone gets a sense that something traumatic and different occurred here.
I think
the curtain was pulled back.
Yeah, I think that's right. That the Eurozone and the European Union behind it damaged its reputation, its moral authority.
Absolutely.
By what it did in Greece. That is correct.
And let me just point out, why the combination of you and Yiannis is so potent here. Yiannis is an authentic patriot, it's clear. Mm-hmm. He gave his soul to this project, it's clear. But he chose you as the chronicler and his aide-de-camp, so to speak. And you're a member of, in effect, a royal family of economics in America, mm-hmm. with a long tradition of history. So you're someone that can't be trivialized in all of this. And you are part and parcel. He called on you as his advisor. And therefore, this link, this process, is well documented and chronicled and can't be trivialized. I don't care what they do short term. Long term, this is going to have powerful knock-on effects. The Bernie Sanders movement, all this, all going to be influenced by this. This is a book that shouldn't have been allowed to be written. They shouldn't have allowed you in Greece to see it. And my God, if I were the Europeans, I'd have found a way to pay the Greek debt off and shut this down and not ever let this become a cause de labor, which it's going to become. This is never going to weigh. The simplest thing would have been find a way to make this go away.
Well, just a
go ahead.
A small point here. I want to make clear. I didn't go to Greece as a chronicler. I went.
I understand that.
As Yiannis's friend.
I understand that.
I did have the liberty to write and speak at the time in public, and I did.
You couldn't have done anything different but be a chronicler of these events.
I'm just saying it was my initiative to
absolutely.
To
I know you were brought that way.
Turn this
but
into a
but you couldn't turn your back on this.
No, that's right. That was the way I felt about it, and that particularly having written at the time and in many cases published my account of what was going on, that there was a remarkable narrative coherence to the whole thing put together, and so it was a responsibility to do that.
So no one could understand that was going to happen. That was going to happen simply because of who you are, the family, the intellectual background, and what you observed was something hugely significant. The fact that you suffered and Greece suffers a painful tactical defeat, mm-hmm. Europe lost the war here. Europe lost the war. This is going to change. People are going to make this change. This is not going to stand. This is not going to be austerity. Dictating to everybody and all the population, this must be, you must do it this way. This is not going to stand. Maybe it'll stand for this year, maybe 3 years, 5 years from now. But I can assure you 10 years from now, this is a whole different world and a whole different environment. And the Greeks set it off. Because everybody, with any wit around the world, could see the forces of power, austerity, entrenched establishment, basically elite control, squishing democratic movements everywhere in the world, aspirations everywhere in the world. They come to a focal point here. The battle is fought, the battle is lost because there's no real strength against the enemy. But there's great moral strength here. And you've done the world a great service in chronicling that.
I certainly witnessed the moral strength. I didn't know Greece very well when I arrived. And when I started becoming connected to it in 2010, I certainly didn't know it at all well. But over this period, I witnessed a great deal of moral strength, of calm, of clear thinking, in the ordinary population. I mean, it's a population mm-hmm. like any other, but in this situation, I came really to have a admiration for the. I was glad I had the chance to be of some help.
We got you. Now I'm going to change the narrative with you here a little bit, because in your book, also there's a very hopeful section that bears on what do we do in a world of automation, outsourcing, elimination of jobs, people wondering what their means of support are going to be. When fewer and fewer people can do more and more of the work, leaving more and more of the population with less to do, what are we to do here? And you have a wonderful section talking about a non-industrial country making its way and surviving in an industrial world that's quite elegant. You've described what a prototypical future Greek economy might look like in the face of modernization. And it's and if you would describe the Greece that you would like to see that could fit in with its comparative advantage, describe in a way that people would be surprised to hear, that a country could compete without being an industrial colossus. Why don't you lay out the vision you have in the book for what a Greek economy could do, rather than collapse on itself and be privatized, which it is, and basically be a set of beachfront properties owned by industrialists around Europe. You gave a coherent narrative of what a population in a country like Greece, that is a defenseless in one way, could do to make its way in the world. And it was a wonderful, wonderful section on economic development. Why don't you describe a Greece that you could see coming from the ashes here? It's a wonderful read.
Well, let me first of all just set up the contrast. What Greece has been asked to do in this program is in effect to cut wages and cut social protections, to cut social services, to cut pensions, to cut to sell off assets. And the idea, the catchphrase here is this will make it competitive. Well, if you're in Greece, you're aware that the industry in Germany is not going to move to Greece, even if the workers there wish to work for free. It's not going to happen, because all of the industrial structure and infrastructure is not in Greece, it's in Germany. And secondly, if you look to the east, the low-wage industries are not going to come to Greece, even if the Greeks work for free, because they are located in China, where, first of all, in international standards, wages are not high to begin with, and they have advantages there of the vast scale and everything else that has made the Chinese economy what it is. So this is a completely non-viable, completely unrealistic strategy. And it's not even seriously being offered. It's not offered with any seriousness of intent. It's a fantasy, clearly. So what's the alternative? The alternative, as I saw it, with the help of some other people who knew the country better than I do, is to say that what Greece should try to become is an economy providing services to the that are valued services to the wealthy and successful and developed part of the world that it's part of, which is Europe. And what can those services be? Well, there are caring services. I mean, this is a wonderful country and with a beautiful environment, and people can come and live there. There are, particularly older people, for example, there are educational services that can be provided. This is a place where one could locate world universities that would become crossroads, if you like, from places that are more troubled and less stable, but they're not very far away. There are cultural services. We're not talking about a big country, so right. 11 million people. One can do the arts and theater and filmmaking, things of that nature in Greece.
And health services was a big
health services, health and caring services, extremely important. So if you're doing that, you're building an economy that meets the needs of not only the Greek but also the larger European population, and that is is much more diversified, moves beyond the 20% of the economy that is now in the tourism sector. Now, there are some industries in Greece, the pharmaceutical industry. There's also agriculture, which can be upgraded. I mean, one of the things you do with niche agriculture is you produce a higher and higher quality product, and that improves the income of the farming sector. So thinking about how to put these pieces together and so that you have something viable for a future Greece seems to me to be a very sensible thing to do. I'm not saying I had all the answers, but we tried to lay out a bit of a vision.
It was a very coherent vision, you know? And it made a lot of sense. And it's eloquently done. You're a great writer. So, to the audience, this is quite a book. It's an emotional book. It's a technical book. It's a book from the heart. And this is going to influence policy for a long time to come. And I'm glad Mr. Galbraith, Dr. Galbraith.
Can you just bring me a copy of it? There may be a passage I'd like to read.
Why don't you read something from the book that seems to strike the essence of the book?
So what will happen? In economic matters, one is never entirely sure. Greece is a small country, and the deus ex machina of foreign investment, a tourist boom, a military crisis, or something else could always supervene. But on the most likely course, they won't. And so the Greek state, Greek businesses, and households will continue on their downward trend, with tax shortfalls leading to spending cuts, loan defaults to foreclosures, and bankruptcies leading ultimately to a foreign takeover of the banking system. That's actually already happened. Meanwhile, the country will be transformed, its marketable assets and real estate sold out. Greece will become something much less like a proud and self-sufficient European nation and much more like, say, a Caribbean dependency of the United States. Its professional population will continue to leave, and its working classes will either emigrate or sink into destitution, or perhaps they will fight. In a world where so many countries have suffered this treatment, where outside certain charm circles it is practically routine, does it matter if one more small and distant place is added to the list? Perhaps not. But Greece is a bit closer to our sensibilities than other places. Its familiarity, its link to the concept of democracy, its European identity are, for better or worse, distinctive. The place pulls at us. It evokes the words that Keynes applied to Germany in 1919. Quote, "The policy of degrading the lives of millions of human beings and of depriving a whole nation of happiness should be abhorrent and detestable." Abhorrent and detestable, even if it were possible, even if it enriched ourselves, even if it did not sow decay of the whole civilized life of Europe. I would add two more reasons, also weighty and honorable. The first is that in the person of Yanis Varoufakis, the Greeks had for 5 months a spokesman of merit, who could and did articulate their case and call it to the attention of the world. That's rare. The second is that when they were given the chance, the Greek people stood up. They said no, and they were prepared at that moment to pay the price. This places an obligation, a moral obligation, on all of us to stand with them.
Absolutely. With that, Panice. That's it for this edition of Smart Talk. For more information on this and past episodes, please go to our website, henrygeorgeschool.org. I'm Andrew Mazzone, and thank you for watching Smart Talk.